Up until recently, Shopify has been a high flyer on the public markets. Its stock has risen more than 350% in the past 3 years. But the Canadian e-commerce player has been under pressure after a disappointing quarter and months of attacks from the short seller Citron Research. CEO Tobi Lütke sat down with BNN Bloomberg's Amanda Lang to explain why he's able to shrug that off.
Sometimes Wall Street gets it really right, and sometimes it gets it wrong. That's what creates opportunity. This is why we generally recommend people to invest in the stock market, because there's potential deals to be had. But I don't manage it. I have no direct relationship to it. And so some of the mechanisms that exist of moving value, the value of a stock up and down, are related to short selling. And I think that's actually a really positive thing, because I think you need that on both sides. Otherwise, this sort of ideal of what Wall Street is supposed to do, which is over time average the value of a stock to the hard to know real market value of a company, is really hard to do without the short selling side. But there are some specific instances of short sellers which are I wouldn't necessarily include in this very productive piece of the short selling world.
When you look at your growth, you have so far grown by adding merchants at a really fast clip. Mm-hmm. How much of your future growth comes from adding services to that existing base?
It's going to be a mix, and I think it's been a mix already in the past. Initially, Shopify was purely a subscription company. Then we built Shopify Payments. Then we built Shopify Shipping, and there's going to be plenty more of these kind of things. What we never built products because of their revenue potential. We build products because of them removing friction. Like, friction is such a small term. It doesn't sound like much. Everyone talks about it. But it really is the only thing between maybe 10-20% of people in the world wanting to own their own business and them doing it. It's like, here's something that's in the way, and that's enough to run out of a momentum that people had when trying, and therefore some business is never going to be created. This is something that I had a personal experience with and I wanted to solve. So now when you sign up again for one of our $29 a month Shopify plans, you're going to get a full payment system with it, and you can accept credit cards from around the world, and everything is already set up for you.
You started this business here in Canada. What's your advice to other entrepreneurs who want to grow the way Shopify grew?
Yeah. So I started the business here in Canada, and I've always, I fell in love with Canada right after I arrived. I thought it was coming from Europe. This is such a place where people are smart and hardworking, and especially this sort of power of. I wonder honestly how many people understand how unique this experiment that Canada has been running for the last 40, 50 years in multiculturalism, how unique that actually is. The whole idea about not just simply assimilating people, but rather actually embracing them the way they are and celebrating their different stories. And so I think people starting business in Canada already have a leg up, because the world is global, the internet is global, and I think in many ways, Canadian sort of cultural norms and cultural values are significantly more progressive, and therefore like significantly more in keeping with how you have to build a global internet company than building it in many from other cultures. And so my advice is one gauntlet that everyone has to run when building a company in Canada is that it is lacking a little bit in role models of companies to
yes.
be like. And so that is false. It's a false narrative. There's a really good reason for how this happened. There's like wonderful books written on each of the various failures that are sort of people tend to point to. But they all happened for internal reasons and not systemic Canadian reasons. And so I was very pro-Canada. I had lots of opportunities to move my company, but I always was really wanted to try this experiment, because I think great companies are created when there's a regional consensus that there's the smart people should congregate in one place and spend a part of their career together and then build something meaningful. And we have tried this in Canada and have found it works really well. And I think the thing you're seeing is there's a lot of interest in the world now in building offices in Canada or even relocating entire companies to Canada for these reasons. It is a brilliant place to build companies. And I think this is just generally better understood now, and I think we'll see a lot more of it.
And in fact, you just moved your Unite conference, which is a hugely well-attended conference, back to Canada permanently.
Yes.
It made me wonder whether we're at a new place of maturation in this country.
I think so. So it's, unfortunately, this is sort of, again, little cultural insight. It's like, it is very, like almost as an immigrant and as someone coming outside of this culture, I spend a lot of my days running around Shopify offices and telling everyone, hey, you guys are world class at what you do. There's no inferiority to any other culture, especially my neighbors, right? And so, but sometimes it just, we started a conference and we said, well, we're part of a tech industry. Okay, where do you go with that? Oh yeah, let's put it to San Francisco because that's where tech is from, right? And we kind of didn't really think about it. And so we had it in San Francisco twice, and then funnily enough, on the last one we did, we had a massive power outage. And so, which is ironic, if you will, like this is the place where all the technology comes from, right, and there's no electrons in the sockets. You know, like, so we can take a hint, and we said, okay, let's look around where we should be. And we realized, again, this is, we have a community where people travel from all over the world. I think we are better, it is better to hitch our wagon to a city that puts multiculturalism on its banner than technology. And so I think it's a fantastic fit for us.
Well, let me just finish then by asking you, this is a company that evolves all the time. What does Shopify 10 years from now look like?
Looking for future looking statements. I think the Shopify of 10 years from now, it's going to be, I think, yet again, a more self-confident company. I think it has more of its strengths, and it has fewer of its weaknesses. It will span the world globe, and I hope that it's going to be an institution where people can point to and say, because this company exists, there is significantly more entrepreneurship leads to successful businesses and leads to people putting their own voices and their own ideas and heritage and craftsmanship back into the global economy, and it leads to more success. And I think those are really, really, really good externalities, and I think those are the things that excite us. And so we are going to work day and night to work on nerdy little details of our technology products to just make it remove one tiny little bit of friction so that the person who's trying to put their voice out there is not going to stumble and actually succeeds. At this point, we have someone on the platform has their first sale about once every minute, and in many cases, this is the kind of event that happens and makes you an entrepreneur, and it's the kind of event that happens which you will remember for the rest of your life, and that motivates us, and that will still motivate us in 10 years, and we hope we're going to get much, 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 much better at enabling these kind of things.
Shopify CEO Tobi Lütke in conversation with Amanda Lang, who joins us with more. Big growth brings big expectations.
Yeah, as we saw in the recent quarter, and that's something else that we talked about, is not just short sellers, but many investors were disappointed to see growth, quote unquote, slowing top line to just 68%. Lütke has been warning for a long time that growth is going to slow. It's the law of big numbers. As they get bigger, you're not going to get the revenue growth that you always did. What I really like about this story is how it really represents a place in Canadian history, a time, in the sense that he was in Ottawa where there was great tech talent available to him because there was all of that great spin-off effect from some big tech companies.
Yep.
He's a new Canadian bringing all this great kind of global viewpoint to this country, which is what makes us so strong and incredible. And he was able to access capital. Omer's Ventures was an early backer of Shopify on its way to unicorn status. And that was a real development in this. You know, there was a time, probably before he was born, when he might not have had that kind of financial support at the venture level. So I think all in all, it speaks to, we can have more of these. This actually really does feel like a time when Canada can keep building on the growth. And as he says, there isn't any reason. We have this narrative that there is, but there actually isn't any reason why we aren't building world-class companies here.
Yeah.
Some have gone wrong, but those are very specific case studies.
And a time when people want to build their own business online very quickly, which has helped them to scale. What I thought was really interesting, he sort of talked to you about the importance of a group of of people building something together, being in the same place, which I kind of took as code for a lot of big technology companies looking to set up shop in Canada, a lot of lawmakers waving their hands saying, hey, Amazon, come here. The leadership of those companies won't be here. The leadership of those foreign technology companies is not here,
That's right.
which is one of the distinguishing factors with a Shopify.
Yeah, one of the big developments in the world is it used to be you went to your capital, right? So if you were getting funded out of Silicon Valley, they wanted you close by. If you were funded out of Boston or New York, you were likely gravitating there. What we're seeing now is, of course, the capital will come here. And it only really took a few big, strong companies to say, we want to stay. Moving that Unite conference, you know, it might seem like a kind of a sideshow. Mm-hmm. It's not. It's actually highly relevant. That's that has attracted people from around the world to come here. And he's saying it's here permanently. This is where it's going to be. Why do they come? It's not just for Shopify and the people they gather. It's because we now have AI. We have quantum. We have all kinds of developments and capital here that will be the next generation of big tech. So, you know, I do, to his point, you get the cluster effect. It's working in Canada. If anything, I think the thing he said, and I must say, I was reminded that new Canadians are often the best Canadians because they see us with such fresh eyes. We are our own worst enemy here. The only thing that can get in our way is us. So to me, the Shopify story is get out of the way of our success and let's take it all on.
It's a great interview. Fascinating story, Amanda. Thanks for sharing it with us here.
Thanks.
The story of Shopify.